And go.
All right, welcome to my presentation.
An educational counselor.
Today I'm going to talk about school counselors in special education. And a lot going on with the counselors and the students. And these are some serious things that are going on in special education. I did research on it and I found that there is a lot of information of things that are not being done with the special education students. So we're gonna go ahead and get started with this presentation. Click the slide for me. All right, so the problem is many special education students are facing challenges when it comes to transitioning into post-secondary, post-secondary options. So in things in regards to higher education, vocational training, and employment, they're not getting what they need unless they're part of some type of specialized program, some type of work experience program. And what another problem is the students who are in special education who lack self-determination are really not advocating for themselves once they get out of high school and go into post-secondary options. Traditionally, the IDEA gives authorization to the adults and to the parents or any of the anybody that's over the student to make decisions on their IEPs, so the students aren't even advocating for themselves. So that is also a problem. So once they become adults, they're having a hard time with that. And then special education students need the assistance of school counselors to help assist them in transitioning successfully. That's like a major thing. And the school counselors have not been as active as they should be. That's what I discovered in my research. That's the problem. That's the reason why I decided to do my research in special education. Because I wanted to see how active the school counselors were with students. Research literature. The review of literature revealed that there is much information on the effects of special education students who lack self-determination. The effects of students who lack the characteristics of self-determination, such as self-concept, self-advocacy, and problem solving are not favorable. The role of school counselor has been identified in the ASC a national model, as we know. However, the delivery of direct services to students with disabilities is not sufficient and consistent. Direct services to all students, including the special education students, is a requirement to meet the standards outlined in ASC a national model. The review literature gave great background information to help justify this study, and the outcomes are very unfavorable for the students with disabilities. The common theme that I found was that the school counselors are not active with the special education teachers, special education teachers or students. It appears that after I've done the research, the special education teachers are responsible for the students' transition. They're helping them with their grades, they're helping them with tutoring, they're introducing them to post-secondary outcomes, and they're not really getting it from the school counselors. And here are a few things that I pulled out of literature. History has shown that students who lack self-determination are less likely to be successful with post-secondary outcomes. That was one, and that was one thing that I also discovered doing my research. Another one, many high school programs have failed at implementing best practices by involving students in their IEP. Again, students are coming out not being able to self-advocate for themselves or do what they need to do because they're not being active in their IEP. Again, like I said, the adults are kind of making decisions for them. They may ask the students, but the students may not necessarily know what their needs are or what they need, depending on their functioning level. Studies concur that adults with disabilities are less successful in seeking and maintaining employment, achieving a satisfactory standard of living, developing independence, and other quality of life indicators than a person without disabilities. So our students are not functioning at the level of somebody who does not have an IEP or is not special education. So that's very, very important. All right, so the data collection, the data collection was done. I did it at Fontana High School here in Fontana, and there are six counselors there. They were given out to all six of the counselors. Only two surveys came back for the counselors, and then I did it with the 20 special education teachers. 11 surveys were returned, and 120 special education students were randomly selected. 107 came back. The special education students who were selected were chosen by five randomly selected special education teachers, and the special education teacher was able to distribute them throughout the day. And so these are the surveys that came back. They were done in the classrooms, and I gave them about a week time span for them to return them. Here's You can't see nobody sitting right here, right?
No.
Ready? Okay, next. This is data analysis and results. These are some of the students' responses to the survey. This one is how overall, there was a series of 6 different questions that were asked to the students, whether they were able to identify who their counselor was, has their counselor been in the classroom doing guidance lessons with them, do they feel like their counselor has helped them with transition. Those different things were asked in the survey. And so I kind of picked these because I thought they were quite interesting. Overall, 50% of the students said that they see their counselors 0 to 1 times per semester, which is very, very minimal. There was 37% that said they may have seen them 1 to 3 times, and 13% said 3 to 5 times per semester. So that 13%, even when I did their, dug deeper and more researched more, they still felt like their counselors did not prepare them for transition though once they graduated from high school. And then here are the students' responses. So 78% of the 78% of the students knew who their counselor were. They was able to identify who their counselor is. And so 22% did not know. Now, I don't know if the counselors were if the teachers told the students who their counselors were. So when they were doing the surveys, I was not there, so I don't know if they asked who was my counselor and they wrote it down. So there's some little bias there. So again, these are the surveys, the graphs from the teacher responses. So overall, 73% of the teachers said that the school counselors are not active with their students at all, 0 to 1 times per semester. 18% said 1 to 3 times per semester. No, 9% said 1 to 3 times per semester, and 18% said 3 to 5 times a semester. Now, to what capacity that the counselors are being active with them, that was not determined. I know that it wasn't favorable when I asked different questions. They did not have a good view of the counselors. They felt like they had done everything for the students themselves to help them transition successfully. And then the other one is the teacher responses to involvement of the IEPs. And 73% of the counselors said that the counselor, 73% of the teachers said that the counselors were not active. There was 27% that did say it, but for the most part, they said the school counselors either don't show up, or if they do come, they don't really know too much about the student, and so they kind of just there and give a little bit of feedback, but they're not really active. So mostly the teachers are, the tracking teachers are responsible for the student's IEPs, not the counselors. And this is the school counselors' responses to the surveys that I gave them. I asked them, do they actively participate in the development and implementation of the IEP plan, meeting a majority of the special education students, and 50% of the counselors said yes, and 50% of the counselors said no. So I don't know what grade level, because these were anonymous surveys. I just know that that's 50% down line said that they do, and 50% said that they don't, which is in conflict to what the teachers said, because the teachers are basically saying that the counselors are never really there. And then another one is there a transition service program in place to help the special education students transition successfully into post-secondary options such as employment, higher education, and vocational training? 100% of them said no, that's not something that they do. That is something that they think that the teacher do. What they said they think. They don't really know, but that's not something that they're doing with the students. So again, you can see that the school counselors are not active with the special education students like they're supposed to, like the American School Counseling Association national model tells us to do for delivery of services. Implications. School counselors are not actively involved in special education population, as you can see, as I just said with the charts. The special education teachers are carrying the responsibility of meeting the students' transitional needs. There have been a couple of teachers who I've talked to, and they said that they will expose their students to different transition options such as higher education, vocational training, and employment. They will also refer them out to work programs that the district has, such as the Transition Partnership Program and the Workability Program. But for the most part, the counselors do not come to the classrooms to do classroom guidance lessons, and they do have the students do portfolios as well. And then students do not feel that their school counselors are involved in their daily lives. There was a lot of students who made comments on their surveys in areas that wasn't even there for them to write on, and they just said that the school counselors are not involved, that anything that they need, they get from their teachers or their parents or their aides. So they don't really have a relationship with the school counselors, and they don't really feel comfortable with going to the school counselors. Intervention. These are some of the things that I came up with, a solution possibly to the school counselors being more involved. Now, the school counselors are very top-heavy. The normal ratio is 250-1, as ASCA tells us, but over there, it's about 550 students to one counselor. They're very top-heavy with general education, so I can kind of understand why. But, you know, we know that we're supposed to be providing direct services for all students, regardless if they have a disability or not. So some of the things that I can think of that would help out is that all school counselors are identified at the beginning of the school year with every student. That door should be open, whether it be in a, you know, by grade level or whether it be a big assembly, so every student knows who their school counselor is. The school counselor should set up a time to come into all the special education classrooms and do 2 to 3 guidance lessons per semester. They don't have to be long, maybe 30 minutes, but it's just kind of exposing them to different things, to self-determination techniques, how to self-advocate, how to transition out successfully if they're wanting to be mainstream. That option should be given to them as well. They should be taught about the military, anything that helps them transition into post-secondary options and be favorable. Should be taught in the classrooms at least 2 to 3 times per semester. And of course, the school counselors should actively participate in the IEPs, because their job is to help the students transition, and we are responsible for the social, emotional, vocational, and education needs of each student. That is why the school counselor needs to be working hand in hand with the tracking teachers, the parents, and anybody else that's sitting at the IEP meetings. And the Middle East. All right, unexpected discoveries. The majority of the special education students were able to identify their school counselor. However, the students did not feel their school counselor has prepared them for post-high school transition. So, although they knew, a majority of them knew, they did not feel prepared. They did not get the information that they needed from their school counselors, which was surprising, because I thought because they knew at least who they are, that they were getting what they needed from them, but they're not. They're getting it from their special education teachers. The school counselor's perception of their involvement with special education students is not the same as the students' perspectives. It's totally different. The school counselors think that they're working with the students, and the students don't think that the school counselors is working with them. So there's clearly a gap there. The school counselors, you know, think that they're doing that they're helping, but the teachers are really doing most of the work. So that was an unexpected discovery. The special education teachers are responsible for students' transition, but also are responsible for exposing the students to post-secondary options. So again, that's something that's supposed to come from the counselors. The teacher should be responsible for the students' academic needs. However, the school counselor is the one that is responsible for the student transitioning successfully out. Next slide, please. Are there any questions? This is up here because this is what I live by, and this is the reason why, and my purpose, and why I do what I do. So if there are any questions, I will take those now. Thank you, ladies, for sitting with me and listening to my presentation. If you have any questions, Drake.
Yeah, I think you need to repeat that again.